The time has come for us to start our meeting. We want to thank all of you for coming this evening. And Commissioner DeRumpel is on the way. DeRumpel is on the way, so that leaves this in my hands. So we're going to adjourn the meeting. Anybody want to call adjournment?
So moved.
Meeting has been called to order. Let us stand now for our invocation. Let us bow our heads. Most precious and wise God, we thank you again for this privilege and opportunity for us to come together on this January 4th day. We thank you, God, for how you blessed us over the past year, and we're praying now, God, that you bless us as we enter into a new year. We pray for our citizens and the Board of Commissioners and the staff, and we ask, God, that you give us the wisdom and the knowledge to do what is right in your sight. We thank you, God, for all that's been said and done. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Let us pledge allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
That was a setup.
Praise the Lord.
That was a setup. That is too timely.
I relinquish my duties.
Thank you. I apologize for being late. Family at home. Hope everybody had a good new year and happy holiday. And good to have everybody here this afternoon. All right. Are there any additions to the agenda? Okay. Approval of the agenda.
Move to approve.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Moving on to the approval of the consent agenda.
Move to approve.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay. Thank you very much. Public comments? Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. Old business. That'll be on pages 42 through 47. Appointment to the Lee County Planning Board, Ms. Lee.
Madam Chair, fellow commissioners, at the December 7th meeting, you instructed me to advertise for a vacancy on the planning board due to Mr. Jay Johnson's resignation. The Sanford Herald graciously did an article for me on the 9th, and I am sad to say that from that posting, I did not receive any applications other than the two, the one that Commissioner Odom had presented at the last meeting, and our first alternate completed an application to be moved up.
Okay.
But no outside applications other than those two.
Okay, thank you.
Madam Chair, as I recall, part of at least my concern was having a husband and wife on the planning board. And I was of the expectation that we were going to resolve that issue first. And so for all practical purposes, until we change our policy one way or another, I don't think that it's right for either one of them to apply until we address that issue. I did speak with the clerk today to ask that our application reflect the question regarding relationships to anyone serving on the requested board. You know, we do that for, what is it, the rest home, I think. If you have a relative that is in a rest home and you can't serve in that capacity, and so for that reason, I would ask that we do the same thing on our application for any board for us to make that kind of determination. And secondly, I would say to you that I'm still of the opinion that we should not have a husband and wife or sister and brother serving on a board. And all boards are important, but this is specifically a board that deals with real estate throughout the county. And I would ask that we reconsider our policy and address that concern. However, I don't know, I don't have the gentleman's name that did apply.
Gillum.
Mr. Gillum was the new application.
Chair, Mr. Gillum's application, which I submitted, his application was for the replacement of Joe Johnson, who resigned, to fill out his term. That was what his application was for.
Well, I don't have any objection with moving on with that request, but the other two, I feel this board ought to decide, or allow them to decide, which one wants to stay on that particular board.
I would like to note, Mr. Reeves, that the part about anyone serving on the Rest Home Nursing Home Advisory Board that has a family member in a facility not being able to serve, that's by statute. That's part of the statute that regulates.
I understand, but it's the same purpose. Mm-hmm. This is the policy that this board can make. I understand the statute, but the same rule applies. There are reasons for that, and I think we ought to have reasons for having two people serving on the planning board that are related. Or in the same house.
Immediate relatives.
Yes, yeah, right. Correct. I think, Madam Chair, we need to look at the policy. So, if that's not part of the policy, we need to make it part of the policy.
Any discussion?
I know in talking to other counties, you know, that's part of their policy is, you know, and they just say immediate relatives, parent, child, spouse, brother, sister, you know. In a community like ours, if you go first, second cousin, in-laws, it starts, you know, it's hard not to cross those intersections sometimes in a small county. Okay, well, it's the pleasure of the board. Commissioner Reeves, do you want to table this until we address the policy issue?
No, I think we can address the policy issue.
Maybe during the workshop, the retreat session?
Put it on the next.
At the next agenda?
On the next.
Okay.
That the policy issue. The other gentleman is certainly eligible as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, I'd like to go ahead and make a motion to appoint Mr. Gillum to fill the unexpired term of Mr. Joe Johnson, which that would carry his term into something like 2017, I think, something like that. Yeah, Mr. Johnson's time's up 2017,
right.
So all he's going to do is fill in that
right. And then he would also be appointed to the Board of Adjustments because Mr. Johnston was in that capacity.
Right.
And I guess I had a question that I didn't get a chance to ask counsel. I know regardless of how the vote goes with both applicants, one was an alternate and one has never been on the planning board before. Will they be part of the hearings moving forward?
Moving forward, not the current.
Okay.
The current hearing that's ongoing, the board is seated.
That was the question that I had. I wanted to make sure. Okay.
No, the board is seated for the current hearing.
Okay, I had that question presented to me and I didn't know the legal answer. Okay.
So, Madam Chair, if I could ask,
mm-hmm.
why do we have alternates if the alternates aren't designed to move up? Because Mr. Overkirsch is the first alternate.
I can't speak for Mr. Odom. I think
my
interpretation of the policy is that's what we've done in the past, is as people have rotated off, we've moved the alternates up. I think what Mr. Odom is saying is that this is not people rotating off and moving people up. This is somebody that's resigned and it's a...
It's exactly what I'm saying.
Well, Mr. Obakersh has applied.
Correct.
When someone's time expires, he can then move up. The way I see that.
And we have, as best I can count, there's five that will come up in June. Is that correct? That's what I had written down. Yes.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. So there'll be five that'll come off in June, and so depending on how our policy discussion goes, you know, the alternates will move up. Is the way our policy is stated, if I read it correctly when I reread it this week, help me out.
We've always tried to move the alternates up if they've been good members in the past.
Right.
But there again, that's the board's.
Right.
I was thinking when I served on the planning board, and that's been a while back, but the alternates, if I couldn't attend a planning board meeting, an alternate came in my place.
That's correct. But the alternates can attend the meetings anyway and just not take part
that's right.
Unless they're needed to make up that quorum.
But anyway, my motion stands. I want to see Mr. Gillum appointed to fill the unexpired term of Mr. Johnson.
Well, how does the rule state? Does he fill the term until the 17th, or does he have his own?
No, he will just finish out Mr. Johnson's term until June of 2017.
Expired term.
And then have to reapply.
He'll have to reapply if he wants to serve again.
But in fairness to the other applicant, he is part of what's in question here regarding our policy. And it may very well be that he prefers his spouse to serve as opposed to him serving when, if the policy changes. And that's the only concern that I would have.
Well, and in going back and looking at our board appointments over the last 7 years, we've done it both ways.
We have
done it both ways. Okay, so we've got the question on the floor.
No, there's two vacancies, right? So.
No, there's one vacancy.
Two applicants, one vacancy. I'm always in favor of people who serve their time should be moved up.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I've ever voted it differently in the time I've been here.
Okay, any more discussion?
I would offer up a motion to perhaps help settle this issue for the time being. I would offer that we waive our existing policy and allow for the appointment or the replacement of Mr. Johnson be moved directly onto the board.
As a substitute motion for Doc?
Yes.
Doc, is that okay?
He accepts.
One more time, I'm satisfied.
Beg your pardon?
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
That we waive our current policy of allowing the alternate to go directly to the board. In this particular case, we have an unusual situation. I've not known this to happen in the past where we have a husband and wife both on the planning board. Now, Mr. Marshall might know of that, but I don't. And I don't support that thought. And that's why I expressed my concern at the last meeting. And all I'm suggesting here is that we waive the policy to allow the appointment to go forward and deal with the policy at the next board meeting.
Does that answer your question, Andre?
So you're proposing that let's get page through this. That Mr. Gillum move in, is what you're saying?
Yes. To the existing position that Mr. Johnson resigned from.
Now, in the meantime, we had the discussion of was either William or Elizabeth contacted about our issues that we were having?
Not by name, no. I did ask Ms. Thompson to request an application for Mr. Obakersh if he wished to move up, which she did, and he provided it.
So my thought is, too, that if you put William in, Elizabeth is still an alternate when she does not have any voting and you're voting statute, and then we can change our policy accordingly.
Well, I won't disagree with that, but she does have, in the event that there's a...
Somebody else.
Yeah.
Yeah, she stepped up, yeah.
And that may be taken care of within 2 weeks.
We probably need to look at the policy overall, because I remember when I was on this board before, we had a policy where you couldn't serve on over two boards.
That's
and now I see
policy.
People serving on, same person serving on four and five boards.
Yes, sir.
I did when I first came back on the board. Yes, I know it's been rectified since then, but I saw that, and I caught my attention. And I said, hey, I know this is against our policy.
I'm in agreement with Mr. Hughes about the conflict on any board like that, and I agree with you on that.
Yeah.
But the point is it's not part of our... ordinance now, so William is going to be penalized for something that's not in the ordinance. So I still feel that moving him up and then addressing our ordinances will take care of the long-term issue that you have, Mr. Reeves, in a couple weeks. So I'm in agreement with that controversy of spouses being on a board, especially one such as this.
If you don't mind, you're saying in a couple of weeks, what?
Well, our next meeting, I think we can address that in our next meeting, rewriting our policies to establish that spouses not serving.
Oh, yeah.
And then Mrs. Overchurch would have to then step down with accordance to policy. And then you can ask Mr. Gilland if he'd like to move in as the alternate.
That wasn't my motion.
I understand. I'm just. Yeah.
My motion was
talking.
To fill in the term, which I don't think. I think this board can do that.
Oh, you sure?
I've added a policy.
Without
we
doubt.
Can.
I'm just voicing my concern.
Okay, well, if there's no more discussion, we've got...
Madam Chair,
sure.
One question. Marshall, what is Mr. Overkirsch's attendance been at the board meetings?
I certainly don't have any official numbers in front of me. I would tell you that he is, just based on personal observations, he's a regular attendee.
Okay. And to add to that, I know it's been difficult in the past to get people to volunteer and step up. But here you have a citizen who has stepped up and he's been attending meetings on a regular basis, and we're just going to flaunt our policy and just slap him in the face and point someone here that's been here a year and a half, according to his application.
Just out of curiosity, in what capacity was he attending the meeting? You don't have to come up, just tell him.
Generally as an alternate. So,
okay,
that's
just like anybody else in the public who would come and watch the meeting.
That's right. I don't recall too many cases where we haven't had a quorum where we've had to have a need to have him serve as a voting member.
And you know, if I point somebody to a board, I expect them to attend the meetings. So that shouldn't be anything unusual for them to be at a meeting. They should be there if they're appointed to that position.
I think the point I think Mr. Smith would make is the point he has done his due diligence as an alternate to be there. And so moving up into a regular position.
Okay, we have a substitute motion on the floor to waive the policy and to appoint Mr. Gillum in Mr. Johnson's position on the planning board as well as the Board of Adjustments. Is that correct? Okay. All those in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Okay, show of hands. All those in favor of the motion. Okay, all those opposed. Okay. So now, do we have another motion?
How did that motion go?
Chair.
It went 3-4 against.
Madam Chair, I move that we elevate Mr. Overkirsch to the position vacated by Mr. Johnson and continue to work on the issue of spouses on the same board.
Okay. Do we also, Ms. Lee, need a motion could we put Mr. Gillum as the alternate to replace Mr. Overkurtz?
Yes.
You want to make that part of your motion?
I'll make that part of my motion, Madam Chair.
Okay. So the motion is to move Mr. Overkurtz into the position vacated by Mr. Johnston and to put Mr. Gillum in as an alternate for the planning board. Is that clear?
Is that just to fill out Mr. Johnson's term?
Yes.
Whoever goes in that slot is just filling the unexpired term.
And then we have five terms up in June that we've got to fill, plus an alternate, I think. My notes are right.
And that person becomes eligible to reapply in 2017.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All those in favor of that motion, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Nay.
Okay. Do you need hands?
Yes.
Okay. All those in favor? All those opposed? Okay. All right.
Now, we don't have to direct staff for the version here.
No, we've already made notes and we'll have it on the next agenda.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, purchase of handguns for the Sheriff's Department. Chief Butler, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Fellow board members. The weapons that we're looking at for one, well, let me back up just a minute. The weapons that we have are somewhere in the vicinity of 9 years old. You can only imagine how many rounds has been through those weapons. In the sheriff's investigation of these 9mm pistols, we found out that the ammo is more easily accessible. The ammo's cheaper, and there's a lot of other departments that we're getting information from that already have these weapons, and they're having nothing but good things to say. We want to take our existing weapons and trade, which you can see the trade-in value of each of the pistols, and then balance it out with the total price of the vehicles, which would have been $54,571, leaving a remainder of $35,606, I believe. Yes, the $35,606.88.
Okay, any questions?
How much is one 9mm?
You're asking how much is one pistol?
Is it 432?
432.46.
Mm-hmm. And then the trade-in value is 245 for the Springfields, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
I'm just curious why the other departments are using the SIG 9 compared to the Glock 9?
The sheriff done the investigation, and he's talked to people from federal agencies and other sheriff's offices. I don't know who or which county he notified, and it's not basically the gun name brand itself. It's the 9mm caliber is what he's decided to go to. SIG, I guess, just being the.
No, 9 is the chip. Yeah, I'm just wondering about the gun. The only reason I say that because it's just more common for the Glock 9. So I was wondering what other agencies, because you always look at that scenario where things are going on and you have to help each other with magazines and things of this nature.
You want to always stay with the same caliber, so you want everybody having the same pistol, the same ammo, just for trading purposes. If one officer needs some extra ammo, the fellow officer there can hand it to him. Dealing with the SIG versus the Glock, I'm not at liberty to start giving details, but I do know that some agencies had an issue at one time with the Glock because it was a safetyless, the manual safety on the Glock didn't exist compared to the SIG. there were some other agencies that were comparing both, and it was just happened to be, hey, we got to choose one or the other. Whether we're of equal, you know, we like both of them equally.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, I move to approve the purchase of 93 handguns and holsters from Lawman Safety Supply.
Okay. Any more discussion or questions?
Who else would be a manufacturer of this particular weapon?
Well, actually, the quote that we got is from, and the letter went to the Sig Sauer Incorporated. This particular company is the sole source provider for North Carolina and South Carolina. I think I've answered your question. I'm not sure.
Well, no, I was asking, it reads as if someone else might make this same weapon.
If someone else might make that
same caliber weapon?
I guess I'm trying to understand, if you're buying it from SIG and they the manufacturer, why you need to certify that?
Is it more like a state contract type deal? No?
Sorry, Mr. Reed, I don't understand.
State contract, they'd be purchasing the same weapon that the state highway patrol.
Okay. What you're looking at is on page 49. Okay, Miss.
To be able to, the cost was pushing them into the informal bid limits.
Okay.
And the way to be able to get, to not have to go through that, is they needed to provide us that they were a sole source provider. There is nobody else in North Carolina or South Carolina that can sell these weapons to us.
All right, that's the answer I was looking for.
Okay.
That's the reason they got the letter, was to satisfy a request from me.
All right.
Understood. Okay. All right. Anything else? Okay, we've got a motion on the floor to approve the purchase with the trade-in. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Stay safe. Thank you. Okay. Facilities needs assessment, Lee County School System, Dr. Bryan. And maybe Dr. Atkinson.
Actually, this is Mr. Crumpton and Dr. Bryan.
Dr. Bryan. Okay. All right.
I don't know if board members who were here 5 years ago remember this, but this is a form basically that comes to the commissioners that is seeking our certification that we received the facility needs survey that they're forwarding to the state and that we have reviewed it. And then we authorize the chair and the county manager to sign the assessment. So the newspaper already did an article on this. I think did a pretty good job, and the total value of the capital is $75,504,083, and most of it is in new facilities and equipment for those facilities. So, and I don't think there's anything in there that we haven't already discussed at one time or another in our CIP process. So,
accurate.
I don't know if there's a
no, I don't think
really
you're
need to add anything more unless there's some questions.
I think you're right, Mr. Crumpton.
So I have one question concerning when you look at the 2015-2016 survey and look at the detail that's behind that and you look at the land, there's, when it says in new elementary school and the second elementary school, there was no land cost associated with the first elementary school. And is that because of discussions we've had in the past about the brick capital property, or
that would be Jonesboro property?
Okay.
No land acquisition. If there was elementary school at the Wicker or brick capital's property, there would be land acquisition cost.
Okay. So is that a true number?
I think what they try to do is they have a formula that they have to, because every school district in the state has to do this. Because of that, there's sort of this boilerplate formula that they use. So it's really, it doesn't always take into sort of consideration the context of the locality and what's going on there.
This is just data compiled by an outside source. It's
correct.
Not your data.
That is correct.
Right.
Although we were, our staff was interviewed.
Sure.
It's only part of the process.
And the Board of Education approved it. Was it the 8th? Yeah,
I believe it was the 8th.
The 8th, okay. So it's been approved. Okay. Go ahead.
I would just say that, yeah, I'm in discussions with Brick Capital right now on the land acquisition cost, and it's nowhere near, it's safe to say, it's nowhere near this amount, but that's kind of a standard number that they use per acre for this. But
and we have to follow their formulas submitting
right.
that information to the
to
state.
To the state, right. Okay. Any more questions or comments? Clarification? Motion?
Move to approve whatever is there.
Okay. There's a motion to approve the authorization for the chairman and the manager to sign the assessment on behalf of the Lee County government. Any further discussion? Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you, Dr. Brown.
Thank
Happy
you.
New Year. Thanks. Okay, budget amendment, Ms. Minter, page 64.
Good evening.
Good evening.
On page 65, you have budget amendment number 10 for this fiscal year. This budget amendment appropriates funds for the following items. IT is to appropriate the funds for the broadband project that you approved at the last meeting. That's $86,000. Social Services has received additional funding for the Crisis Intervention Program and low-income energy assistance from the state, and those are 0% match of county dollars. So you'll see there's about $9,000 total in those two line items. And then you have an appropriation of fund balance in the Drug Seizure Fund to purchase the guns that you just approved in a total of $32,000.
Okay. Any questions or discussion? Motion. Okay. Motion on the floor. Any more discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Approval of fiscal year 2016-17 Johnston Lee Harnett Community Action Community Service Block Grant. And I know Ms. Watson's not here.
I am.
Okay. Hey, come on up. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year to you.
Thank you.
To all of you. Each year, in accordance now with the folk power that be in Raleigh, we've always submitted you a copy of our application. And so now we have paperwork to say that we have submitted to you and that you've approved it. What we're a self-sufficiency program, and you have a budget, you have the information in front of you. And what we're doing is trying to help 25 individuals in low-income individuals in Lee County rise above the poverty guideline to overcome whatever barriers to self-sufficiency they may have, whether it's in the area of education, employment, housing, financial literacy, all of those things, putting it together so in the end that they will be, for all intents and purposes, self-sufficient, which is for community services block grant means that they are not relying on any other entity to meet their needs, that they are working, gainfully employed, a viable part of the community.
Okay, thank you. Any questions or comments?
I move to approve the Johnson Lee Harnett anti-poverty grant as presented.
Okay. Is there a motion? Any further discussion? Okay. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed?
No.
Thank you for all your hard work.
Thank you so
and
much.
Please pass along our best wishes. Thank you.
I will. You have a blessed evening.
Thank you. Okay. Now.
Thank you guys for all the hard work you do. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
Now, moving on to the county manager's report.
Yes, ma'am. Just have an update on the Coleman Road water sampling. Over the holidays, Environmental Health received another 17 letters from property owners in the area, bringing the total number of letters received to 51. They were
requesting
out
testing.
Requesting testing. So they were out testing 6 properties today and had to order an additional 11 kits to do the remaining 11. As of today, 10 property owners have been informed that their water tested positive for elevated levels of chromium and vanadium and have been told not to consume or cook with that water.
How many was that, Mr. Crompton?
We're up to 10.
10.
And Mr. Kane is, yes, sir, chromium and vanadium. Did I pronounce it right?
Vanadium.
Vanadium, excuse me. I'm not a chemist, or I don't pretend to be one. I didn't learn all my things there, like Dr. Connect had to do.
It's all right, that's why we got in.
That's right. And Mr. Kane is here if you have any questions for his department. At this time, they have started working with DEQ, researching the properties as to why we are having those elevated levels.
Well, I just have one question, and I think this was something Mr. Reeves asked to be done last week, I think at our last meeting, to see what the cost would be for
extending water
from the city
yes, would be for it to be extended out to this area.
We are working on that.
You're working on that. So we haven't got that information back yet.
We're going back over, you know, what they've asked, you know, what they provided us before, and going back over those numbers and making sure those are accurate numbers because they're kind of pricey.
Mm-hmm. So. And the reason I'm asking those questions is I've been getting a number of phone calls from the citizens out in that area about the water situation, and I posted them about, you know, maybe taking care of the cost or what could they do with the cost, and just to throw something out there at them, and they just wanted to know what it would cost for them to be involved in that, to get.
Well, there are two separate issues. One is the running of the water on public right of way, and then running of the water lines on the private property to their property, which is a, you know.
Well, I don't think that running on the private property and the hookup fee is an issue. I just think that they just want to get the water line ran to that area. That's the biggest issue that they're having. The hookup and the private property issue is not a problem with them. So I just wanted us to try to do what we could to get something as quickly as possible.
Yeah, I don't think he's suggesting that the county pay. He's merely asking if the individual families on those private roads want to get water hookup, approximately how much would it cost, which makes good sense to me. So maybe, I think you all have
we have an interlocal on the 11th. We'll be talking about that, like priority one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It is on the agenda.
Agenda. go ahead.
What do we have? We got 26 families that have not been responsive or have just refused or denied. I think you said we had 77 at one point.
The original number we sent out was 77.
Yeah, right. So
23 of those property owners responded and the remaining property owners did not.
Okay.
1,000 feet.
Okay.
So there's 17 and actually 4 more this afternoon, so that makes 21 have responded from a half mile.
When is the cutoff?
16.
January.
Well,
you mean as far as the
31st?
Right.
January 31st, yes. Yeah.
And we're already, you know, I got a phone call today from somebody that was at the half mile, wanted to know what was going on.
And we're getting
they don't live
problem.
Local, and
okay.
They had not heard a word. of what was going on.
So my question is, with the other 26, are you saying 23 did respond, but out of the original 77 mailers that went out, we had 23 responses from those.
Okay. So there, so that would make 54 that did not respond.
Yes, sir. And to be honest, a lot of them that did not have any pond and or well on the property, but there were some that did have one or the other.
That did not respond.
Yes, sir. Okay. Yeah, now I was thinking that you... And some of the letters we received from the 1,000 feet barrier and the half mile parameter don't have those water features either that we received. Mm-hmm. So I got a call today asking the Ada County Water, do we need to check it? So that answers no, they've got county water available. So. And people have questions, and we've been responding to those as they call. All right.
We heard anything from the state yet?
DEQ called December 18th, so they were still researching the information, so they should have something pretty soon, but I've not heard anything since then. No, sir.
Thank you.
Heath, what's the turnaround, you know, like the test that you went out, and I know it's not a set time, but just basically when you went out today and tested those, now that the holidays are passed, which always messes things up, you know, and you get those turned in, about what's the expected?
State lab will get them tomorrow morning. They said it usually takes 3 to 5 working days to get the chlorine test back, and they said 8 to 10 working days for the coal ash panel test to come back.
Okay, so
we're
about 2 weeks.
About 2 weeks before I can actually officially send a letter out. The Kent property owner we called the week of Christmas, I did not have the coal ash panel information, I only had the chromium result.
Right.
So that's why they were called, but I have not sent a letter yet because I haven't got that second piece of information yet.
Okay.
As opposed to maybe sending another letter to those, I was thinking, I thought I heard 51, you say 21 in all. 54 now.
But that includes the half mile.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Which we sent out, Yeah, 229 additional in the half mile.
Yeah.
So 229 and 77, so over 300 letters. Over 300 letters.
229 additional
to the original 77.
Yes. That would be good in here.
300 letters.
That's okay. I'm quiet sometimes too. I was just wondering if before the 31st, maybe we could do a public service announcement reminding folks that the deadline will be.
I'm all for that.
Do that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Just to get information out.
Yeah.
And maybe if the newspaper could help us some too on that.
Right.
And I know the radio station would as well. Okay.
Madam Chair, I just want to share the last meeting we had. I had some very positive comments from your behavior and your interaction with us. Citizens, so thank you very much.
Yes,
sir. Thank you all for letting me do it.
Definitely. Sorry you're having to do it, but you're doing a great job. You're doing a great. Sorry you're having to, but you're doing a great job. Okay. Anything else on that? I'm looking over at Marshall. Do we have a set date for that for the meeting and the meeting that we're talking about while Heath and Marshall are both here? Is with the Environmental Affairs Board that we tried to...
Yes, Madam Chair, we do not, unfortunately.
Okay.
I am still, the real problem is trying to get a commitment from the state.
Understood.
Because we feel like it's really not really practical to have a meeting without having folks there to answer the questions. So once we can get a commitment from Dr. Rudo, working with Heath, he's been very helpful in trying to make that happen. But we still, as of today, haven't got an answer on that. I think we're running into a little bit of... red tape from the standpoint of why are they coming, what's the purpose of the meeting, that kind of thing. So as soon as I can get maybe some of their figures allayed, then hopefully we can get them down here.
Well, and I think to just get the board up to speed, you know, over the holidays, April Montgomery and I have been talking leading up just about to Christmas Eve, I think, was some of our last conversations, is that there's so many unanswered questions for us at the local level, but yet we need to be very responsive to the citizens. I mean, they're being told not to cook or, you know, drink their water, and we're trying to get the state to come in with DEQ and someone from the state health department to meet with members of this board and the environmental affairs board, because Ms. Montgomery and I both felt like we had more questions than answers, you know, from our standpoint. And we needed the folks from the state to come in and help us kind of navigate through this so that we could better serve the citizens.
Madam Chair, just to be clear, at this point, we're really just trying to get Dr. Rudo from the Health and Human Services, I believe that is.
Yes.
Okay.
And not so much with DEQ at this point, because they're even more unclear, to be quite honest with you, at this point.
I understand.
So we felt like, at a minimum, Dr. Rudo would be very helpful in answering questions from the public as well as assisting the boards with questions. So that's our target.
Right.
Once we can get confirmation, work with his schedule, then the information will come back to you all, and we can try to get that meeting set up.
Okay. And that's one of the things we're going to work on hard this week. You know, manager and I'll try to do what we can to help you guys and get that set up.
Do you think that a joint letter from the mayor and our chair?
I'd have to defer to Heath. I think at this point, and I apologize, Heath, I haven't had a chance to follow up with your voicemail you left me, but I think at this point, his superior, I guess, is needing more information about.
Tutter C.
Go on, back up. I'm sorry.
All this has happened this afternoon. I mean,
we're coming off the holidays. Understood.
Dr. Sheehy has to have the foundation for why he can come, basically for that public forum to meet with the county, but she has to approve him coming.
Gotcha.
So when I called her and left the message today, she called back at 2:30, somewhere in there, this afternoon, and said she just needs some more information, so I forwarded that call to Marshall to get him to explain in more detail what she was looking for. But she has to approve that visit to us.
Gotcha. Okay.
Hopefully, your short answer is you won't need to go through all that. I think hopefully I can do a good enough explanation that should do it.
And then if not, I'll be happy to call or email.
Absolutely.
Because, you know, Ms. Montgomery and I, the way we're looking at it is not so much a forum yet for people to ask questions, but more a workshop for us.
Yes.
You know, and the Environmental Affairs Board.
Yeah, the intent would be, our idea in talking with Chair Montgomery would be the EAB would host a meeting, invite the commissioners.
Mm-hmm.
You all would have an interaction, a forum where staff would present and interact with you. We would invite everyone within the half mile. We'd do that mailing list and have the public there, certainly be open to the public. But like you said, it would really be just more of a workshop between the boards.
Yes, so we can learn, you know, more about the process and what's going on to start with.
So.
Okay. Well,
once we get that set, I think everything else will go quickly in motion.
Okay. Well, I'll certainly be back in touch tomorrow and we can get this going.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments from the board? Okay. Thanks, Marshall.
Thank you.
Okay. Commissioner comments. Start with Commissioner Reeves.
I had a very rewarding experience at Dr. Fraser's church yesterday. I let him know that after hearing him pray for a young lady, that I want him to use that same tone he talked to God about men. I want to come strong. He did an excellent job. But it was a really, really nice program. I wish you all could have been there. I appreciate you.
Thank
inviting
you.
Me.
Just want to say Happy New Year's to everyone, and glad to see all of you, and that you are healthy, wealthy, and continue to be wise. So thank you all so much for all that you're doing.
I just hope everybody had a great Christmas and a safe New Year. Thank you.
Yeah, welcome back, and I do want to publicly apologize on the, I believe it's the 16th. Of January, we're invited to a Dr. Martin Luther King celebration in Broadway. I will be in South Carolina. So if you all can attend in my place, I'd appreciate it.
Okay.
Just to come in on Mr. Commissioner Reeves, yesterday we had a Freedoms Day celebration at one of the local churches, and as a presiding elder, we invited the community, and we had a not a standing room only, but we needed more room. So we want to thank those who participated and shared with us yesterday. That's what Commissioner Reeves is referring to.
All right, well, again, like to wish everybody a happy new year, and very hopeful and optimistic about 2016 for Lee County, and I hope it is a more healthy and happy and prosperous year for everybody, and we will do what we can to help along those lines as much as possible. We're always here working for you on your behalf. So with that, I think we've got a motion.
Okay, I move we go into closed session to consider personnel matter per North Carolina General Statute 143.18.11(a)(6).
Okay, we are in closed session. Okay. Call this public hearing to order. This has been advertised as the public hearing to consider an economic development project, Project Core. And I'd like to call on Mr. Bob Joyce.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mm-hmm. Good evening, Commissioners. Thank you for the Happy New Year wish. I don't know whether you pray for winter weather or not, but I guess we finally got some winter weather. I did see snow this afternoon. So.
That's cold coming to this meeting. You just waited.
Project Core is the first item on our list tonight. And I have been given permission by the company to disclose the name this evening. And we usually choose, or someone, sometimes the state, chooses names that don't have anything to do with the project, but this one actually is appropriate. Project Core is a local company, Coremark, formerly J.T. Davenport Wholesale. So they are considering a project that would be a total investment of $1.5 million. The completed project would add about 25 jobs and would have an average annual wage of $31,800. If the Sanford location is chosen for this project, this project would add new distribution equipment, and there would be some new products that would be distributed from our facility to meet the increased customer demand. If we're chosen, the expansion will take place in the second quarter of 2016 and for the rest of the year, and then be completed in 2017. This board has asked me each time to report to them if a company pays a portion of health insurance for their employees, and this company does, as well as additional benefits that are competitive in the marketplace. This company has had no major safety or environmental citations, and the investment here would add value to the local facility, and we think would make it more likely that they would make investment here in the future. There is competition within Coremark for this project. They expect a decision to be made by mid-January. State assistance will be requested. A local match is required. Currently, there is no community college training proposed. The local incentive grant will be requested from both the city and the county. So we'll have an official public hearing tonight at the county, tomorrow night at the city. Then we would send our proposed agreements, which would be our normal agreement. This would be on a five-year incentive at the schedule that this board had approved before, the 75, 60, 60, 50, 50. Percentage based on the exact amount spent. The estimate that we made based on that amount of the incentive would be $26,354.25, and that's what we advertised in the public hearing. And I'd be glad to, we do expect a corporate decision by February 1st. And if anyone has any questions, I'd be glad to answer.
Any questions?
You might know this one. I just can't get the number right in my head. What's minimum wage annual salary right now? Okay. Anybody?
$7.25
is
minimum. Minimum
wage
is
$7.25.
Yeah,
but annual.
Annual. 2,080 hours. $15,080.
All right.
So it's right at about $15 an hour.
All right.
Isn't that correct?
That's correct. These jobs would be just a shade over 15. Mm-hmm. Average is a shade over 15.
Thank you.
Okay.
Move to conduct a public hearing as advised for this date and time and approve the proposal for project as presented.
Okay. All right, we'll go into the public hearing. All those in favor of approving Project Core S?
Cannot. We haven't had the public hearing yet, so you cannot approve the project.
That's what I was going to say. All those in favor of approving, they want to speak.
In favor of
approving. Right. That's
against is what she's doing.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Right?
She's opening it, right?
The motion also included the second part, which says, and approve proposed
project. Oh, okay.
Project
well, we just need to do the public hearing. Yes, you're right.
The second part.
Okay.
You're not, I didn't think you did that.
I did.
So, okay. Yeah, so.
It's in the motion.
It's okay.
Okay. I just moved to conduct the public hearing as advised for the date and time.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye opposed. Okay. Public hearing's open.
Okay.
All those that would like to speak in favor of Project Core. Anyone to speak in favor of?
Madam Chairman, I will say that we do believe this is a good project. This has been reviewed by the Growth Alliance Executive Economic Development Committee, and they do recommend this project. This is, of course, a longtime local industry that has recently been sold to the national corporation. They are good corporate citizens, and we think this is a good project and speaks well of Sanford for them to make that investment here.
Okay, thank you. Okay, anybody else in favor of? Anyone to speak in opposition of approving Project Core as presented? Okay, public hearing is closed. Okay.
Move to approve the proposed project as presented.
Any discussion?
Do we have to first waive our policy? Do we have a policy? No. Yeah.
We still have to bring the agreement back to the board, so there's a second vote, so that's within the policy.
Thank you.
Got a motion on the floor?
What was the motion
again? I have no idea.
Approve them.
Thank you.
Everybody's got it.
To approve the proposed project as presented.
Thank you.
Okay. All right. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Okay.
Five to two.
Okay. Then the second item, again with Mr. Joyce, for Project Winter. At least the name's appropriate for the time.
That's right.
Yeah, last week it went to work.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. On Project Winter, this is an extremely confidential project. It is still, we are in close competition with at least two other states. If the Sanford location is chosen, this project will modernize equipment with new technology and relocate a new product line to our community and our facility. The total investment in machinery and improvement to real estate is $30.2 million. This is a six-year project. It will add 25 jobs. The average annual wage for these jobs is $45,000. Again, this expansion will take place over a six-year period. It will begin in the second half of this year, and the machinery, the bulk of the expenditure, would likely be purchased in 2017-18 timeframe. This company also pays a portion of employee health insurance coverage as well as additional benefits that are competitive in their marketplace. They've had no major safety or environmental citations. We also think that this very significant investment in our location here keeps our facility viable and makes it more likely that we'll receive future investment. There is internal corporate competition for this project, and once our offer is transmitted along with the state's incentive package to the company, which would be in a week, we expect a decision by the 1st of February with an announcement coming in the spring. They will also be requesting state assistance through a One North Carolina grant. A local portion of that grant needs to be matched. They also will seek community college training and local grants from the city and the county. So we'll have our hearing here tonight, tomorrow night at the city, and then transmit our draft documents to the company. Any questions, I'll be glad to answer. Oh, on this one, we are deviating from our policy because we felt that it was very important for this industry that we be competitive with the other two states that we are we know that we're competing with. So this would be a 6-year grant period with a 70% grant. So that incentive could total up to $583,746.24, and that's the figure we advertised in the public hearing. Now, I'll be glad to answer any questions.
When you mentioned, Mr. George, when you mentioned a portion, and I noticed that you mentioned that on the other, a portion of health care or health assistance, what is that percentage? Do you have any idea?
I don't know the exact percentage.
Okay.
But I could get that information.
Okay, thank you.
Any questions?
I would open the public hearing.
Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Okay, we'll open the public hearing. All those or anyone that would like to speak in favor of this project?
Well, this project has also been reviewed, Madam Chairman, by the Growth Alliance Economic Development Committee, and they do recommend this project to you.
Okay, thank you. No, it's okay. It's fine. Yeah. Okay, anybody else like to speak in favor of this project? Anybody to speak in opposition of this project? Okay. Clear the public hearing closed. Okay. Okay, discussion.
I have a request. Well, it's not related to the motion. Would it be possible for your recommending or approving board to send forth a copy of their recommendation to our board for the future?
Yes.
Included in our packet or whatever. Right. Yeah. Okay, we've got a motion on the floor to approve Project Winter as presented. Any more discussion or questions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No.
Okay. All right.
Madam Chair.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Joyce is available to give his monthly report if the board would like to hear it tonight.
That's right.
Okay.
With these hearings so quickly.
Yes, I think that would be perfectly acceptable. If that's okay with everybody. Just a nod of hands.
Only if it's good.
For him to just give a month, his month before, because we missed it December 21st.
That's great.
It was too crazy.
Great. Right, thank you, Madam Chair. I think this is a good report, Commissioner Reeves. We currently have 20 active projects.
Wow, fantastic.
And I will say that there are a lot of times when we respond to these requests, We send in information, and then if the company does not make a decision, until the company makes a decision, we don't really hear what stage that's in. A lot of times when we make follow-up phone calls, particularly to the new economic development partnership in Raleigh, they are not at liberty to say to us where we are in the process. So when I tell you I have 20 active projects, I do have 20 on my spreadsheet.
Mm-hmm.
And we've sent in information. We continue to send in community information if they ask for it. But I don't strike them off until we find out that they've made a decision to locate somewhere else.
Right.
So sometimes they'll stay on there, 12 months. But I just want to add that caveat. I still think it's good news that we've got 20.
I do too.
Mm-hmm.
We continue to see most of our activity in manufacturing of those projects. Two-thirds are manufacturing projects. They're in machining, which is kind of our wheelhouse. People come to us, particularly with those types of projects, because we've got that labor pool here. We've got that expertise. The community college is really good at training people in that field. We've seen more chemical formulation, mixing type operations, and we're seeing a number of those, and then also assembly. But assembly now is not just standing there turning a wrench anymore. It does have computer applications, and we're also seeing some wholesale distribution facilities. We're seeing a few retail inquiries. I will tell you that we have four people talking to us right now about breweries. Brewing craft beer is a national phenomenon, and every community, it seems, has their local brewery that they've kind of adopted. So
it's like awesome.
Yeah. So we're
used to be bootleggers.
Yes, we are. And now we're working with four legitimate
Yeah.
But now they're all in the beer business, but the state has approved some liquor distilleries, so we'll see. I will say of the manufacturing and industrial clients that we're getting, about 75% of those are looking for buildings, and about 25% are looking for sites.
Okay.
So again, that kind of backs up what we're seeing nationally, where people are, as business has improved, particularly in manufacturing, they're looking for space to manufacture, and they need it right away. They're not looking for a place to build a building, mm-hmm. unless it is a new product line. We're seeing some more of that in automotive. We're getting some automotive folks to look here. What has happened is that's reduced the building inventory everywhere. We had, for example, two buildings that Static Control vacated on Rosser Road. So if you turn off Broadway Road onto Rosser Road, going towards Lowe's Hardware, turn left onto Rosser Road, it was the first building on the left, 904, and the last building on the left, 921. Both of those Static vacated. They came up for lease. We've shown them to a lot of people. The first building is 40,000 feet. The building at the back is 50,000 feet. Good ceiling height, well insulated buildings, and they've drawn a lot of attention. So much so that the 40,000 foot building is gone. So it stayed on the market about 45 days for lease. So it's been leased by a local company. That, I think, tells you how quickly we're starting to see square footage turnover. And we're seeing lease rates go up a little bit. The lease rate on those buildings was $295 a square foot. So we're starting to see that. We've seen lease rates at $1.90. So we're starting to see lease rates increase. The lease rate in Wake County, if you can find a building, is between $6 and $9. So we're still on the economical end of that. So I think that will help us as well. We have just one building that's 100,000 feet, and that's the American Treats building. I was trying to think, looking for John for help. Balloons, Inc., American Truth. So that's at Rex McLeod Drive. And it's just over 100,000 square feet. And that's drawn some traffic to high ceilings, wide bays. It's a secure facility. It has good dock height doors with the air levelers on it. So it's a good building, adaptable. And then we've got a couple of smaller buildings in the 30,000 foot range that are good quality buildings. We've got a couple of buildings. The former Patriot Performance Materials building is available at a very attractive lease rate, $275, and good building. So again, lease rates are increasing. We've still got the best large certified track in the middle part of the state, if not the entire state. And one of the best in the South. The track that is on the northwest side of US 1 and Colden Road is still the best site for a campus type facility. So if we have particularly pharmaceutical that's looking for a campus type facility, very secure, that's probably the best site in North Carolina right now. We'll have in Enterprise Park on the other side of the road, I was not here for the meeting where the broadband was approved, but now that we've got broadband out that way, we're gonna have some smaller tracks that will be very viable. And we do have some people that are looking for those 20 and 30 acre tracks to put a smaller building. One of our issues at Enterprise Park that we're working on is trying to get all that land under common ownership. There are 6 or 7 owners of that property, and some parcels are owned by family corporation that has 4 or 5 people in it. And with the speed that business likes to work at today, we really need to get those under common ownership to have one entity to deal with, because most of the requests I get, I have to turn around in 3 or 4 days, and decisions will be made in 30, 60, 90 days, so very, very quick. So the Growth Alliance is working with a group of investors to try and put that under common ownership, and I think that will help us a lot in the speed at which we can react to things. Right. So if you all have any questions, I'd be glad to try and answer them.
Any questions?
How many certified sites do we have in Lee County?
We just have one certified site. We did have a former site that was certified, but those certifications are only good for 5 years, and they lapse after 5 years, and you have to renew them. So currently, we just have this one site. It's about 450 acres, so it's a good-sized site. And, of course, that certification process is a state process. Phase one environmentals are done, archaeological's done. There's a concept plan that's done, water and sewer there, so it's ready. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
The Sanford Herald did a series on 3 different days on all the vacant buildings on Horner Boulevard.
Yes.
What's the plan?
Always a very difficult difficult thing to entice investment back into the deteriorating core of the city. Cities face that all the time. They constantly dying from the inside out because the older stuff is in the middle, and if owners of those properties don't keep them up and they deteriorate, there are some things that you can do, I think, and they have to do with zoning, that you can allow higher density. You can, where you might require more parking for some place like Walmart, where they, based on your square footage, there's a formula that planners use to say you got to have this many parking spaces. Well, you can reduce that and try and entice people to come back to the city center. So I think there's some things with planning and zoning. Marshall would know much more about that slipped out or I would have turned it in pretty quick. But, you know, those are the kinds of things I think. There's some, you know, there's some things to look at that, that entice investment back into to a city center. There's a lot been written recently about how you revitalize downtowns, and all of the experts, no matter where they are on the spectrum, and not just politically, but concept-wise, are saying that residential close to your downtown is what really revitalizes downtowns. If you can entice residential next to your downtown, so I think that's something that, again, we could work on to entice developers that would build residential to come look at some of those downtown properties that may have big old buildings on them that we could tear
There's
down.
There's something to say about walking somewhere to get something real quick.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I travel
over in Cary. They are building around those developments and seem to be working out. One quick question. Does Downtown Development Corporation work on the same projects that you're talking about, these vacant buildings?
They do, and have made some recommendations to the planning office, so I think that's...
And one other thing, I think it'd be a good idea for you to at least send Marshall a note regarding what you said. Maybe we ought to be looking at that in advance. I know it's within the city, but sometimes planning needs to realize that the easier it is for an investor to come in and do business, the more likely we are to get an investor.
Kurt, did you
have a
question?
I was still following up. I just we had a presentation here some years ago on Cumnock Village,
mm-hmm.
the development up there. What's
mm-hmm.
the status of that?
So the investors in Cumnock Village have added to their property out there, and they've also purchased three other large tracts in Lee County. So they continue to see us as a good investment. I've had two meetings with them. They are actively marketing those properties through NAI Carolina Real Estate, a commercial real estate broker in Raleigh, one of the largest in the South. They have some concept drawings for mixed use, residential, and other uses. But they would likely on the other tracks they bought be very interested in water and sewer extensions, because the other tracks they purchased are in areas where we do not have city services yet.
That's city department. Some of the travels I've done in recent years, and I'm bringing up two places, Ramsour and Harrisburg, had large, old industrial textile plants that they demolished and built something on. I don't know who did it, if it was the private company that came in, demolished the buildings, and then had the property available. But I know the one in Harrisburg, I'll be passing that in a couple of weeks, has a huge construction project going on there, looking like a mixed-use village
mm-hmm.
sales,
mm-hmm.
marketing, or a shopping area.
Mm-hmm.
going up there. And again, that's more of Charlotte expanding. But I'm just curious if we can find out who did the purchasing, who did the renovation. And there's two developments. One there in Ramsour, they tore down an industrial site, and in Harrisburg. Be interesting to see what they formulated, how that came about.
Are you referring to Ramsour, North Carolina, or?
Yeah, Ramsour, North Carolina.
I know
right there
is.
On US 64. Mm-hmm.
And I thought you were talking about Pennsylvania. So
yep.
No, you say Harrisburg?
Harrisburg is off of 49, just outside of Charlotte.
Okay.
That's
north
of
Charlotte. That's where you go.
Very large. It is very large industrial. It probably was an old textile plant. It's been abandoned for years. Drove by it many a time, and all of a sudden it demolished it. Something's going
to actually, they have developed homes on the side of that.
Right.
Yes.
It's a combination of both homes
yeah.
and a commercial.
It's right there at the drag strip, almost on 29.
It used to be out in the country.
Yeah,
from Charlotte. Now Charlotte's grown all the way.
Yeah, Charlotte's eating everything up. Okay, any more questions for Mr. Joyce?
I can move this one.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you so
very
much for all your hard work.
And thanks again for coming.
Yes, definitely.
Keep us in touch. Thank you.
Okay.
And it was a good report, so thank
you. Okay, I think we have to ring that bell again, please.
Right. I move that we go into closed session to consider a personnel matter of your North Carolina General Statute 143-18-11A6.
All right, we're in closed session.